Old Testament reading is Joshua, chapter 5, verses 9 through 12, and it's on page 197 in the Bible. The Lord said to Joshua, "Today I have rolled away from you the disgrace of Egypt, so that the place is called Gilgal to this day. While the Israelites were encamped in Gilgal, they kept the Passover in the evening on the 14th day of the month in the plains of Jericho. On the day after the Passover, on that very day, they ate the produce of the land, unleavened cakes and parched grain. The manna ceased on the day they ate the produce of the land, and the Israelites no longer had manna. They ate the crops of the land of Canaan that year." The epistle reading is 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 16 through 21 on page 181. "From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view, even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view. We know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ Jesus was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ. Since God is making his appeal through us, we entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." And the gospel reading is Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 3, and 11b through 32 on page 78. "Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to him, and the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying this, 'This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them.' And then Jesus said, 'There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the property that will belong to me. So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in dissolute living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of the country, who sent him to the fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead, and he is alive again. He was lost, and he is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his eldest son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked, "What is going on?" He replied, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has got him back safe and sound." Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, "Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. And yet you have never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him." Then the father said to him, "Son, you were always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found." Thanks be to God.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The gospel lesson is an old familiar story to all of us, the story of the prodigal son. In that story, Jesus is in the midst of people who are judged by the society as just a mess. And he's also standing in the presence of the Pharisees, who thought, all in all, they were pretty good. He tells both crowds gathered there in front of him the story of a son, a youngest son who did a despicable thing to his father, a youngest son who would have been a scandal to the community, a youngest son who exhibited absolute disregard and callousness of heart towards his father. He went to his father and said, "Old man, you haven't died yet, but I'd like to have my inheritance so I can get on down the road." In that society, in that patriarchy, such a statement and such a behavior would have been unthinkable. The father relents and gives inheritance to the young son, who indeed goes down the road, but not to a better place, or a happier place, or a more wonderful place. But he goes right on down the road to hell. In the midst of his turmoil, his distress, his brokenness, symbolized by his desire to eat the pods that are given out to the pigs, the most unclean animal in Judaism, by the mercy of God, he comes to his senses. And in that horrible condition, he says to himself, "Maybe I can go back home and be a servant, a slave in my father's house, for that surely would be better than what I have gotten myself into here." He goes home. When his father sees him, that father's love explodes in his heart. He can't contain it. He loves his son so very much. If you've ever been disappointed by a family member or by a child, perhaps you understand what that father was feeling that day. That explosion of hope and opportunity. That explosion of welcoming, of just overflowing with love and joy, and the old man runs down the road to greet this child. The son says, "I've sinned against you." And the father immediately starts barking orders with a big smile on his face. He says, "Get a fine robe and place it on my son, not these rags that he's been reduced to." He says, "Get a fine ring and place it on his finger. Get sandals for his feet. Kill the fatted These things are symbolic. The party reminds us of the kingdom feast that will one day be ours when we are all united with the Lord in heaven. It reminds us of Holy Communion, the feeding that comes from God, the celebration that we belong to God, that we are children of God, and so we are. Every Sunday is a celebration of the resurrection of Christ. Every communion is a celebration of Jesus with us. The good robe reminds us of the good of many colors. It reminds us a statement of our identity of belonging in the family and being able to count on the provision of God for us. The sandals on the feet remind us of security, something that helps us to stand strong and firm. And the ring on the finger, that's a statement of office, that he is not a slave, he is not reduced and rejected or diminished in any form, but has office in this family enterprise. He is restored as the son of his father. It's a story of joy. Joy of when a son comes to his senses. Story of joy when one repents of their naughtiness. Story of the incredible love and the amazing grace of God for all of us, each and every one. But the curious thing about this story is that while we call it the parable of the prodigal son, we might better call it the parable of the older brother. Perhaps that parable of the older brother would have more resonance for us this morning as we sit here in the sanctuary of God. You see, the curious thing about this story is that it doesn't end with a happy ending. We think it's a happy ending. I mean, sure, it's a happy ending for the prodigal son who's restored and welcomed home. But the story doesn't stop there, does it? The older brother comes in from the fields. He sees the party. He sees the best robe. He sees the sandals. He sees the ring. And he's not pleased. He says to his father, "Hey, I work like a slave, a dog for you. These many, many years I have been there. I am the oldest child. I am the dependable one. I've stayed home so that when you get into your old age, I'll take care of you. You won't have to be shipped off somewhere. I'm the one. When did you do this stuff for me? When was I given a banquet or a ring or a robe or sandals? Huh?" Father says to that son, "Remember, your brother was dead, literally dead to me, but now he's alive." Corinthians says, if a person is in Christ, they're a new creation. The past is finished and gone, everything becomes fresh and new. There's newness here, son. Your brother is restored and new. And the parable stops. We don't know how that hit home with the oldest brother. It just stops and it dangles there. I wonder how that worked in Jesus' sermon that day. There were the sinners and the Pharisees. I wonder if the Pharisees got the point, or whether they thought it was a parable of the prodigal son sinner group and not a parable of the oldest brother to them. I think there's some of that oldest brother in each and every one of us. I was talking to a fire chief yesterday. And as we talked, I asked, how many people are in your department? About 60. And as we talked further, I said, well, how many actually regularly, dependably show up to fight fires? That's why I have a fire department. 15. And I thought, I wonder how those 15 feel about the other 45. Can you imagine? I belong to a fraternal organization. It has about 500 members. I talked to the person in charge of that group and said, well, how many people regularly show up and participate and carry the load? And that person said, oh, about 20. Belong to another fraternal organization, has about 300 people. How many people are there doing the work of the organization? 20. I'm starting to wonder if there's some kind of rule of 20 for organizations, that organizations operate when they have 20 older brothers. That's what you need to carry the organization. Then I thought about this church. About 120 members, about 80 people, give or take, in worship. 21 officers serving effectively, a choir that can sing like angels. Activities all over the place. Koinonia groups, men's fellowship, women's fellowship, and goodness, if you want to see a well-organized machine, come to the yard sale. And then I think of other churches who are very proud of themselves. We have 2,500, 2,600 members. What's your attendance? Oh, in our five services, 1,200 people on a Sunday. Yeah, we can easily get caught up in that syndrome of being the older brother. Hey! I'm working like a dog here for you, God. Hey, I'm working like a slave. When did I get the banquet? Or the robe, or the ring, or the sandals? This last week, I must confess, I was both amused and dismayed by some of our political opportunities. It took me back to remembering when I did a course in organizational development in my doctoral work at Drew University with a fairly renowned fellow named Roy Oswald. Roy Oswald said over and over and over again in organizational development, it is important to measure, and it is important to know what you're measuring. I'm going to behave myself. You see, leadership requires us to measure our mental capability. We want leaders with great minds. We want leaders with great hearts who care about the people that they care for and are entrusted to care for. We want leaders with great spirits, and we want leaders with great faith. And in that particular moment of the older brother, he had lost his perspective. He measured his sweat equity. He measured what he had gotten out of the deal. He measured everything except the point, which is to rejoice that his younger brother had come back to life and was returned to the family. We too, who serve, we need to remember this parable of the older brother. We need to see things from the perspective of the kingdom of heaven and not our own vested interests. We need to remember with the tender heart of Jesus Christ the people that he came into the world to die for and to live for and to love, and we need to We need to have a spirit of enthusiasm like that of the Father, whose heart exploded in joy when people came into contact with the good news. And we need to have a faith, a powerful faith, that cares about the family of God, and not just we ourselves. I believe that you as a church have that. And in a world that is ridiculously polarized, we need that kind of spirit in our leadership. And we need to be that kind of leadership in the world. So next time you hear someone talk about the parable of the prodigal son, I charge you as dedicated, committed Christians to pause and say, oh no, it's the parable of the oldest brother.